Welcome to Space News from the Electric Universe, brought to you by the Thunderbolts Project at thunderbolts.info. The myth of an electrically sterile universe is dead. Only those who paid little attention to discovery could think otherwise. But close attention must be paid indeed, since institutional science has made no attempt to contextualize the development as significant. As we've reported many times, electric currents in space, long verboten in the astronomical literature, is now acknowledged with increasing frequency at all scales of cosmic investigation. Scientific papers propose that colossal electric currents flow through the light-years-long jets exploding from active galactic nuclei. Some radio astronomers estimate the strength of such an electric current as comparable to a trillion bolts of lightning. In our own solar system, the electric currents that connect the gas giants Saturn and Jupiter to their respective moons is also now recognized in science literature. However, like the spectacular electromagnetic cosmic jets, space scientists heretofore have always proposed that the electric currents are the result of strange magneto-fluidic processes. Yet rather than affirming these interpretations, finer technological data increasingly challenges standard theory, while confirming the electric universe prediction of electrical circuitry connecting the bodies in our solar system. In fact, the Saturnian moon Enceladus displays some of the most dramatic electrical discharge activity seen on rocky bodies in our solar system today. Well over a decade ago, prior to the arrival of NASA's Cassini spacecraft at Saturn, planetary scientists had expected Enceladus to be, quote, geologically dead. Instead, they found explosive filamentary jets shooting material at tremendous velocities up to hundreds of kilometers from the moon's surface. Adding to the surprise, the jets were seen at the moon's south pole, the last place they expected such activity. As reported by space.com in 2005, the finding flipped everything scientists knew about Enceladus on its head, because what should have been a dead moon appeared to be geologically active, and what was supposed to be the moon's coldest region turned out to be its warmest. Astronomer John Spencer said of the discovery, "This is as astonishing as if we'd flown past Earth and found that Antarctica was warmer than the Sahara." Since their discovery, scientists have interpreted the features as so-called ice geysers, which they view as a form of cryovolcanism, probably resulting from Saturn's gravitational forces producing tidal heating within the moon. Over a decade ago, Cassini's plasma spectrometer discovered evidence for electric currents in the jets that compose the plumes of water and dust. In recent years, a number of papers have been written on the presence of negatively charged dust grains in the so-called plumes. Today, scientists studying data from the Cassini spacecraft are reporting that the electrical circuitry connecting Enceladus and Saturn is more, quote, powerful and dynamic than conventional theory had proposed. The NASA press release from July 9, 2018 states, "New research from NASA's Cassini spacecraft's up-close grand finale orbits shows a surprisingly powerful and dynamic interaction of plasma waves moving from Saturn to its rings and its moon Enceladus. The observations show for the first time that the waves travel on magnetic field lines connecting Saturn directly to Enceladus. The field lines are like an electrical circuit between the two bodies, with energy flowing back and forth." Planetary scientist Ali Suleiman says of the findings, "Enceladus is this little generator going around Saturn, and we know it is a continuous source of energy. Now we find that Saturn responds by launching signals in the form of plasma waves through the circuit of magnetic field lines connecting it to Enceladus hundreds of thousands of miles away." It remains the position of planetary scientists that cryovolcanic activity on Enceladus releases the spectacular filamentary plumes, which then become ionized. However, when we consider the latest scientific data and juxtapose the respective predictions and interpretations of standard theory versus those of the electric universe, we see a consistent and stunning victory for the electrical viewpoint. Consider first a scientific paper published earlier this year based on data from the Cassini-Langmuir probe, which suggests that negatively charged dust grains have previously, quote, blocked the signal of the powerful electric currents in the Enceladus jets. For a number of years, standard theory has proposed that electrically neutral water molecules are ejected from the moon's surface, where UV rays from the sun and interactions with plasma in Saturn's magnetosphere strips electrons from the water molecules, forming positively charged water ions. In theory, these ions are then free to be, quote, picked up and merge with co-rotating plasma, supposedly generating an electric current. Cassini scientists had estimated the strength of the jet's electric currents based on disturbances to Cassini's magnetometer instrument. But as noted in the summary of a scientific paper in the Journal of Geophysical Research, when Cassini flew through the icy plume, its instrument sent back vastly different readings. According to the craft's Langmuir probe, which measures particle density, there were enough ions present to generate a current of 10 million amps. The magnetometer indicated a current more than 20 times weaker. The authors provide experimental evidence that ions like those in the Enceladus plume are, quote, attracted and trapped within the sheaths of negatively charged dust grains. They conclude that, quote, Cassini's Langmuir probe is measuring the entire ion population, free and trapped ions. While the Cassini magnetometer detects the magnetic perturbations associated with pickup currents from the smaller population of free ions, with this distinction possibly reconciling the ongoing debate in the literature on the ion density in the plume. Simply put, these results are anomalous for the standard, quote, pickup ions model, but they are expected if the surface of Enceladus is being etched by electrical discharge machining, as physicist Wall Thornhill has always proposed. Electrical discharge machining works by stripping electrons from high points on a surface. In this process on Enceladus, positive ions generated on the surface are heated by electric discharge and electrostatically attracted to follow the electrons into space. This does in fact explain the high loading of positive ions that the Langmuir probe measured. Let us also consider the hypothetical processes that planetary scientists must invoke to try to explain the explosive plumes generation. Given the icy cold temperatures of the moon at its vast distance, nearly 900 million miles from the sun, it seems preposterous to suggest that solar warming could produce the plumes. So it's believed that Saturn's gravitational influence produces tidal heating within the moon, creating the explosive outbursts. However, science discovery continues to challenge the tidal heating explanation, both for Enceladus as well as for the so-called volcanism on Jupiter's moon Io. In 2013, scientists reported that the locations of the so-called volcanic plumes on Io are completely incompatible with the moon's internal heat signatures. The lead author of a study on the findings stated that it, quote, can't be reconciled with any existing solid body tidal heating models. Likewise, on Enceladus, in 2016, scientists were amazed to discover that when the so-called geysers on the moon are producing the most water and dust, the accompanying gas output was anomalously low. As reported by space.com in 2016, the researchers expected quite a lot more gas expelled at the far part of Enceladus's orbit to help explain the outpouring of dust, but they found the gas output had bumped up by just 20%, far less than expected. The leader of the study said of the findings, "We had thought the amount of water vapor in the overall plume across the whole south polar area was being strongly affected by tidal forces from Saturn. Instead, we find that the small-scale jets are what's changing." A recent article by Thunderbolts Picture of the Day managing editor Stephen Smith succinctly summarizes perhaps the most obvious objection to the tidal heating model. Although the south pole of Enceladus is warmer than it, quote, should be, it is still 261 below zero Celsius. So-called tidal kneading from Saturn fails because the theory has no explanation for why the effect is limited to the southern hemisphere. A fundamental challenge to conventional theory is the belief that celestial bodies cannot carry net electrical charge separation. The electric universe, however, recognizes charged bodies that are connected via electrical circuits across the vastest cosmic distances. The electrical connection of the sun to the planets is one of the great and ongoing surprises of the space age. It is a concept that was proposed well over a century ago by the electrical pioneer Christian Birkeland, a concept that was confirmed by the discovery of Birkeland currents in the Earth's upper atmosphere, which power the earthly auroras. More recently, over a decade ago, while investigating the Northern Lights, NASA's Themis spacecraft made the completely unexpected discovery of so-called magnetic ropes, which rapidly form and unravel and are connected to intense auroral displays on Earth. Nearly a decade later, in 2016, scientists reported their first ever observation of similar magnetic ropes traversing the 880 million miles between the Sun and Saturn and connecting the two bodies. The lead author of a paper in the Geophysical Research Letters said of the findings, "Contrary to previous ideas about Saturn's magnetosphere being unlike its terrestrial counterpart, these findings reveal that Saturn at times behaves and interacts with the Sun in much the same way as Earth." The term magnetic ropes is used to describe twisted, filamentary pathways traversed by charged particles. We have suggested many times that such terminology is misleading and inappropriate. The so-called magnetic ropes stretching from the Sun to Saturn are electrical Birkeland currents. The rope-like form is the structure taken by current flow due to the long-range attraction and short-range repulsion between current filaments. As outlined in numerous episodes, in recent years, Professor Donald Scott has developed an original mathematical modeling of a Birkeland current, whose structure is identified visually as counter-rotating coaxial cylinders of current filaments. It is then not a coincidence that this counter-rotation is clearly seen at the north poles of both Saturn and Jupiter. The electrical interaction between Saturn and Enceladus may be comparable to that between a comet and the Sun. Comet jets, like the plumes on Enceladus, are electrical discharge phenomena that heat and eject surface material. In fact, over a decade ago, scientists were astonished to discover a, quote, comet-like chemistry to the material in the Enceladus plumes. As Cassini investigator Hunter Waite stated, "A completely unexpected surprise is that the chemistry of Enceladus, what's coming out from inside, resembles that of a comet. But like the jets of comets, the matter is coming from the surface and not the interior. It has always been the position of the electric universe that water molecules detected in cometary comas is the result of electrochemical processes, a fact which resolves how desiccated, rocky comet nuclei can still produce prodigious amounts of water, sometimes even at great distances from the Sun." We note again the recent NASA press release, which states, "Plasma waves travel on magnetic field lines connecting Saturn directly to Enceladus. The field lines are like an electrical circuit between the two bodies, with energy flowing back and forth. Electric currents in filamentary jets exploding from Enceladus' surface. Electric circuits connecting Saturn and Enceladus. Electric currents over hundreds of millions of miles connecting Saturn and the Sun. Such dynamic electrical interactions between the Sun, the planets, and the planets' moons were never anticipated in gravity-centric cosmology, but they are only to be expected in our electric universe."